joined ARS service in 1985, and he did MSc Botany from Lucknow University, PhD in Botany, Plant Virology from the same university, and after that he did postdoctorate from Rutgers State University, New Jersey, USA. And he has guided about a dozen of MSc and PhD students at IERL. And he is a fellow of two prestigious academies, National Academy of Sciences, India, National Academies of Agricultural Sciences. And he has also received the Best Teacher Award of IERL. And he has availed the Overseas Associateship of DBT from 2000 to 2001. For 1 year, and he is a member of different policy committee of Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, and he has delivered invited lectures in various countries like USA, Brazil, and Thailand. So his today's topic is actually the introduction to plant viruses, their transmission, and implications of diagnosis. Now I request Dr. Barinwar to deliver your lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pant, for introducing me to the trainees. I hope your journey must have been comfortable to reach to Delhi. Many of you have come from far off places. Was it okay? The weather in Delhi is just perfect. It is neither warm nor cold. So it is the best time in Delhi, and you should enjoy your stay for the next 10 days. Coming to the training, this is the first lecture, and I would just like to share my own experiences in the diagnostics, and which will encompass the different facets of diagnostics for plant viruses. So you all know that before the turn end of the 18th century, we were not aware of plant viruses. We were only aware of fungi and bacteria, isn't it? So when the disease in tobacco was noticed and when it was causing huge economic losses, scientists in Europe and other countries started working on, but they tried their level best to identify the causal pathogen, but they almost failed in most cases. Then Bezerinke, he for the first time did experimental work which showed that it could be neither fungi nor nematode nor bacteria. And he used the term or coined the term contagium vivum fluidum. That means infectious living fluid. So that was the beginning of plant virology world over, and the science of virology since then has been moving very fast because of the change in our understanding using molecular tools particularly. So the era between 1900 to 1939, there was only indirect evidence of presence of virus. So Stanley crystallized it and said it is proteinaceous. But then in 1939, when electron microscope was invented, and using that machine, tobacco mosaic virus was for the first time visualized. And it was a rigid rod of about 300 nanometer and 15 nanometer in width at that time. So if you have to define virus, there are many definitions, but the one which I have mentioned here is a set of one or more nucleic acids, template molecules normally encased in a protective coat or coats of protein or lipoprotein, which is able to organize its own replication only within suitable host, not all host cells. So this was the definition, and after the discovery of tobacco mosaic virus, we now know more than 2,000 plant viruses, And you can see that they have been categorized. The detailed classification will be taken by one of our esteemed colleague and our ex-dean, Dr. R.K. Jain. So he'll be talking about details of classification. But here, just to briefly make you acquainted, they have single-stranded RNA positive sense, single-stranded RNA negative sense, double-stranded RNA, single-stranded DNA, double-stranded DNA virus. And if you look at the shape, you can see that they can be hexagonal or spherical, basally formed, monopartite to multipartite, rigid rod, flexuous. And so there are so many viruses. They cause different kind of symptoms, or they may not cause symptoms at all. Okay? So how to detect them, how to characterize them? That is a big challenge. So in nature, all these viruses, how they spread, how they move, they generally move through insect vectors. And the most important insect vector, most of you who are from plant pathology are aware that they could be aphids, they could be white fly, they could be thrips, beetles, and so on, mealybug. So this is called horizontal transmission. When the virus moves from one plant to another plant, they are being horizontally transmitted. But there is another kind of transmission, what we call as vertical transmission, that is from the mother plant to next generation of plant. So that would be possible through seeds or sets or through tissue culture plants. So these are the basic two types of virus transmission, and based on the transmission, we develop management strategy. Just to give you an idea about the different kind of symptoms, you can see that they can produce yellow mosaic, leaf curl, mosaic mottling, yellowing in rice, shoestring symptoms in papaya, golden mosaic in citrus, bunchy top, banana, and ring spots. So all these symptoms are only indicative of virus. You cannot say that which virus is there. Now, how to go about the diagnosis of virus? That is the main question. My question is, can we determine the species of any virus through electron microscopy? Can you raise the hand? Can we determine? Like tobacco mosaic virus was identified. So if you see any particle, can you say which virus is there? Why? So it will be only indicative of structure, morphology. You cannot say which virus is. So to determine that, what we can do? We can still use electron microscopy. We can go for immunosorbent electron microscopy. So one can use specific antibodies. If it is able to decorate the virus particle, you can then say that it is particular virus. So there are different methods of diagnosis. Based on symptoms, we can only say it is a viral disease, could be a viral disease. Then you have to bring the sample to the laboratory. You can go for biological indexing, or you can go for electron microscopy. And the most common method is immunological or nucleic acid-based method. So why viral diseases are important? If you see this slide, they cause yield loss in terms, they cause losses in terms of yield, quality, and productive life. Vegetative crops have high virus incidence due to long exposure in the field. Okay? Difficult to get healthy clonal material for in vitro propagation. Correct identification and indexing of viruses are prerequisite for production of healthy planting material. And virus diagnostics are also essential for sanitary, phytosanitary certification as well as resistant screening. So this is why the diagnostics are important. What are the challenges of diagnostics? So the most important challenges I have mentioned here, that generally they occur in low amount. So it is often difficult to detect them. Many of the plant viruses are still unknown, not characterized. There are always unavailability of quality antibodies for efficient diagnostics. Complex, if you talk about PCR, so there is a complex nucleic acid template preparation protocol for RT-PCR or PCR-based detection. And then plant may be having multiple infection of viruses. So that is another big challenge to detect different viruses and detection of unknown viruses. So there could be a virus which may be present in the plant, which we are not aware about. There is no previous information available. So I have taken a case study of a couple of crops just to give you an insight into the diagnostics. So grape is one crop which is host of how many viruses? Anybody can say, tell? 12. Okay. Anybody else? Guess? Who said 60? Okay. So he said correctly. It is almost about 65 or more viruses which infect grapevine and about 7 viroids today. So till 2000, and grape is, you know, highest foreign exchange earner in fruit crops in India. So till 2007, we were not aware of any virus or virus disease in India. So in 2008, a news came in Indian Express, virus strikes Maharashtra vineyards, imports stopped. So then we were asked at that time, our head was Dr. Jain, and he asked us to start working on grape viruses. And in 2010, I went to Maharashtra. I carried survey work along with the director of NRC grapes. We collected many samples. So this is the picture of this is a nursery. All the plants were showing virus-like symptoms, but there was no report. And that is how the viruses were getting disseminated. And this is the leaf roll symptom which we observed in the field. So we brought the sample, we kept in a greenhouse, started working on viruses. And then based on the literature, what we found that there are 2 important viruses which are commonly present in leaf roll disease of grape. So they are called grape leaf roll associated virus 1 and 3. I will just skip this. So we did ELISA for these 2 viruses. In addition to these 2 viruses, there were reports for presence of grape leaf roll associated virus 2, grape leaf roll associated virus 4, 5, 6, 9, and 7. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So there were 9 viruses at that time reported. But we went for testing of only 2 viruses. Using ELISA and PCR, which are the 2 most common methods. I will not talk about it in detail because another speaker will be talking in detail about serological assay. But just to give you an idea that ELISA can detect very low concentration of virus. It is suitable for large scale testing and can be standardized using kit. So here it is a picture of double antibody sandwich ELISA. We just coat the well with the antibody, specific antibody, and then you add the antigen, and then you add the conjugate, and you add the substrate. If virus is present and binds with the antibody, you will get the yellow color. So we did ELISA, and you can see that most of the samples which we collected from Nasik and experimental farms of NRC grape, they were positive for GLRV3. So this was the first official record for the presence of virus using ELISA. So this was possible only when antibodies were there. Similarly, we did for GLRV1, so in couple of vineyards we could detect this virus. Subsequently, we also worked on other viruses associated with leaf roll disease. So GLRV4, could get associated with many samples. So we went for the production of antibodies. So as I said, antibodies are very important component of any serological assay. How antibodies are generally produced? From where antigen will come? You must have heard virus purification. Why virus was purified? The one reason was to get purified form of virus to be injected into mammalian system for production of antibodies. So the first and four requirement is purification, isolation and purification of virus. So that was the practice until the molecular biology tool or recombinant technology became available, okay? So this practice was used for production of antibodies, but it has inherent problem because you cannot always get virus in a purified form. It will always have host protein. The other problem is that when you are isolating virus from a field sample, you are getting mixture of viruses. So separation of a specific virus species is always a big challenge. And third, once the source of antigen is exhausted, you have to again go through the process of virus purification. So to overcome all these things, recombinant technology was used for production of antibodies, and this was done for GLRV3 and GLRV4 in our laboratories. So the coat protein was cloned, amplified, and expressed in expression vector. And then after purification, this is Western blotting just to ensure that we are getting the target protein. And purified expressed protein was then injected into rabbit and you get the antibodies. So this is the most easiest way of getting antibodies these days, okay? And the most important component of polyclonal antibodies is IgG. There are five types of antibodies. Why antibodies are so specific, my question is. Okay, but there are thousands of viruses, and if you inject in rabbit, you get different types of antibodies. So variability in antibody is 10 to the power 9. That is why you get specific antibodies against a specific antigen. So using that antibodies, we standardize DAS ELISA, and we determine the titer of antibodies. We also check the cross-reactivity, whether the antibodies which we have produced reacts with other viruses like GLRV3, 1, other strains of 4. So it was highly specific. And when we validated these antibodies and collected a lot of samples from Maharashtra. And you can see that in 15 and 16 and 16 and 7, a large number of wines were positive with GLRV4. So later on, we concluded that it is not GLRV1 or GLRV3, but GLRV4 was more dominant in grapevine orchard. So from where it has come? So it has all come through importing material from outside, okay? And that was, we confirmed this because NRC grape was importing a lot of good quality grape wine, and they were importing through NBPGR. NBPGR gave the samples to us. When we tasted, we found that couple of samples were positive with GLRV4. You can see here. And one sample was positive with GLRV1. So based on this information, they were asked to destroy those samples. Even GLRV4 is present, but these may be even variants. So we cannot allow the entry of infected material. I will take another example of soybean as a case study. In grape, you saw that it is a vegetatively propagated crop. It is host of more than 5 dozen viruses. In soybean, what do you think? How many viruses? 60,
more than 60.
In India, how many are reported?
Seven.
So he is correct because he is working on soybean. Okay. So soybean is one crop. If you, how many of you have seen soybean crop? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So soybean, you often see the symptom of either mosaic or yellow mosaic. And based on that, you think that it will be either soybean yellow mosaic virus or mung bean yellow mosaic virus, or it can be soybean mosaic virus, which is aphid transmitted. So in one All India coordinated research program study, one of our colleagues studied the symptom pattern during different crop growth stages. So initially what she found, yellow mosaic specks, then necrosis after 30 days, complete yellow mosaic, after 45 days, necrotic specks, necrosis, bud blight, and death of some plants in some genotype. Then green mosaic or mottling appeared only after 50 days in some of the accessions, and then mixture of all these symptoms after 60 days. So based on the literature survey, we screened 9 viruses using ELISA or RT-PCR. So you can see that of 9 viruses, 7 were positive, one in 21 genotype, another bean, black gram motile virus was positive in 35 accessions. Cowpea mild motile in 6, cucumber mosaic virus in 23. I mean, it is very difficult, beyond imagination, that you will get cucumber mosaic virus. But in 23 accessions, groundnut bud necrosis, a tospovirus transmitted by thrips in 39 accessions. Mung bean yellow mosaic India virus was present in almost all accessions, all the 71 accessions. And tobacco streak virus was present in 60 accessions. So all these viruses could be detected or identified because of you had diagnostic reagent either in form of antibodies, or you had genomic sequences and you had designed primer and you did RT-PCR. So further study also indicated that many of the accessions had more than 5 viruses, mixed infection in different combination. So almost all the accessions had at least 2 viruses. Only few accessions were infected either by one virus like mung bean yellow mosaic or cowpea mild motile virus or tobacco streak virus. So in field condition, when you are screening for any resistance, you should know you are screening against which virus. And that in most of the universities, we do screening only based on symptoms. And you go for publication of paper writing resistance variety or cultivar against this virus without testing whether that virus is there or there are any other virus. So it is very, very important that whenever you are doing field screening, you have to always test all the known viruses which are reported in that crop. Only then you can say that this accession or cultivar is resistant to this virus or that virus. This is just to show you a glimpse of the symptom. They are more or less same, but associated with different viruses. You can see yellow, green mosaic, mottling, yellow mosaic. So they were all associated with this virus. Only mosaic, green mosaic, still it has Mungwin yellow mosaic virus. So if you see only green mosaic symptom, it doesn't mean that it is not having Mungwin yellow mosaic virus. It will still have. So there could be masking effect also. Similarly, crinkle, green mottle, all types of symptoms we encountered, and we could associate different viruses in different combination with particular symptoms. So this is an overview. So coming from ELISA, the most recent technique is, serological technique is lateral flow assay. How many of you have heard? So lateral flow assay is available for which virus? Any? So lateral flow assay is nothing. It is basically a membrane which is impregnated with the antibodies, and then there will be secondary antibodies. I'm not going into details principle, but what I am trying to tell that there is a control line and there is a test line. When you add the SAP, so these strips are available only for specific virus. So it may be available for Citrus tristeza virus, it may be for tobacco mosaic virus, it may be for specific virus. So you can test only one sample at a time. The advantage of lateral flow assay, also we call deep stick, is that the assay can be performed in 10 to 15 minutes. And many of the commercial lateral flow deep sticks are available, which are being supplied by FDA. The only limitation is that sometimes its sensitivity is slightly lesser than ELISA. Okay? So this is another serological method. Now coming to nucleic acid based detection. How many of you have done PCR or RT-PCR? Raise your hand. Okay. So what is the most laborious step? Tell me. You have done yourself? What is the laborious step? What is time consuming?
Adding of all the mixture.
Adding of all the mixture. Where? So first component is to go for nucleic acid template preparation, whether it is DNA or RNA. So how many of you have used the laboratory protocol? And how many of you have used the commercial kit?
Both.
How much time it takes?
Manual method for the RNA and all, it depends upon 1 day and 2 days.
1 day, 2 days, 1 day should be enough. Yeah. Commercial kit, 2 hours at least it takes. So I will just talk about this. Can we simplify this? Because in PCR, this is one of the very important component where most of us have to spend time and energy. The other components are primers, DNTPs, magnesium ion, the enzyme DNA polymerase, and reaction buffers. So these are all components. I hope every one of you are aware of these components. So if you look at the history of PCR, it was Mullis who published a paper in 1986 on specific enzymatic amplification of DNA in vitro, the polymerase chain reaction quant biology. And then it was used for the first time of a human virus in 1988. But plant virus, when it was used? Any idea? It was used in 1990 for detection of PCR was used for the first time virus as well as wire. Okay. 1990 by Rivki use for Maize Streak virus and other Gemini viruses. One settle for being yellow mosaic virus in gladioli and Hadidi and Young for from palm fruit wire. So 1990. So almost after 4 or 5 years of discovery. And from 1990 to 2000, there were more than 100 publications on plant virus detection using PCR or RT-PCR. And then variants of PCR came. What are the variants of PCR? Anybody? One. Okay. The first variant which came was immunocapture PCR. Okay, 1993. What is immunocapture PCR? Now, this is the first PCR modification where you have dispensed the use of nucleic acid isolation. You don't require nucleic acid isolation. But what you require is antibodies. So if you have antibodies of a specific virus, then you can trap the virus particle in a PCR tube, okay? And then after trapping it, you can denaturate by heating and you can release the nucleic acid, whether it is RNA or DNA. And then you can directly perform PCR. So this was the first simplification of PCR, where you have dispensed the use of nucleic acid isolation, okay? Then in 1994, as I said, plants are often infected by more than one virus. So he developed multiplex PCR for the first time for 5 seed-borne viruses. So that was another variation. Nucleic acid requirement, you all know, principle of nucleic acid isolation. So it is nothing but disruption of cell wall and membranes to liberate the cellular component. Inactivation of DNA or RNA degrading enzyme depending upon the target template. Separation of nucleic acids from other cellular components. So these are 3 basic principles, okay? And then finally, you go for precipitation or extraction of nucleic acid. So in any of the commercial kit or lab-based protocol, you have to follow all these steps. I will just skip this. You, in lab-based protocol, you add phenol chloroform isoamyl to separate other cellular components, and then in aqueous phase you get the nucleic acid, you precipitate with sodium or ammonium acetate and you can repeat it, and then finally you can go for extraction and precipitation. So this is the common laboratory practice. So we were thinking, can we dispense the use of phenol chloroform isoamyl? Can we directly precipitate DNA from the cell lysate? So in 2001, we started working for citrus virus called citrus yellow mosaic virus, which was a DNA virus. So just after crushing the leaf sap in a particular buffer, the cell, after centrifugation, the sap was directly added with the isopropyl alcohol, and there was a precipitation of DNA. We skipped the step of phenol chloroform, and then this was compared with the commercial kit, and also it was as good as commercial kit, the DNA quality and quantity. So this was published in Journal of Virological Method you can refer to. It is highly cited paper, more than 60 times it has been cited. We went for further simplification, wherein what we did, we even dispensed the use of precipitation. We used a buffer, and after grinding the leaf tissue, we spotted on the NCM membrane. And this NCM membrane was using the, kya bolte hain usko? Punch hole, punching machine. You can take out and heat it in water at 80 degree or 90 degree, and you get the DNA. So that has been demonstrated, and it was using this sap, the PCR was performed, and you can see the intensity of band was as good as commercial kit or the previously developed lab protocol. So this this DNA template preparation was also reproduced for viroid detection. So many of the viroids could be, viroids are relatively stable RNA compared to RNA viruses. So this was not successful for RNA viruses, but this was very successful. Now the advantage of membrane based method is that you can take the sample in the field condition, spot, like you want to screen 500 samples. We just grind spot using micropipette, 20 microliter or so, and you can bring to the lab and do PCR. You, if you don't have facilities at your center, you can just send this membrane by post. And we have seen the stability of this membrane up to 3 months. So even after 3 months, you can elute the DNA and do PCR. There was no adverse impact on DNA template preparation. So this protocol is simple, inexpensive, rapid, applicable to large scale surveys of any plant, can be stored for future testing or for long distance sample transport to a detection laboratory. So this method is very useful where the virus concentration is generally high. If the virus concentration is low, it may not work. We have to standardize. And it has not been very effective for RNA viruses. But definitely for DNA viruses, it is wonderful. So the other variation of PCR, as I just talked a while ago, is multiplex PCR. So in citrus, we were working, because citrus is host of many viruses and one common greening bacterium, which is not culturable. So here we developed duplex PCR, and then we went for multiplex PCR for 5 pathogens, 4 viruses and 1 greening bacterium. So this is a work of a PhD student. What is important for multiplex PCR? Nee, what is important? So one has to design primer which will give amplicon of a particular virus of different size. And the primer TM value at which annealing temperature is decided, that too should be closely ranging with each other. And all these primers should not cross binding. So one has to always check that primers are not binding with each other. Okay. So after a lot of permutation and combination, we could develop multiplex PCR for citrus ring spot virus, citrus yellow mosaic virus, citrus greening bacterium, yellow vein clearing, and CTV. So there has been some advances in PCR-based diagnostics. How many of you have heard rolling circle amplification? Okay. So many of the DNA viruses, they are circular DNA viruses. and they can be amplified through an enzyme called 529 polymerase enzyme. So you can get the complete circular DNA. Okay. Now, to get this amplification, unlike PCR, you don't require prior sequence information. Why? So you use random hexamers, no? So they bind randomly and then they produce circular molecule. So this rolling circle amplification is very useful for vigomoviruses, which are very common, and you can always go for its characterization using rolling circle amplification. And this we have used extensively for another group of viruses called Bedna virus, that is basally formed DNA virus. Anyone is aware which this virus causes which disease in which crop? So in banana it is very common, causes banana streak disease. So the most common virus is banana streak Mysore virus, but now we know more than half a dozen banana streak viruses, and they can be identified only through rolling circle amplification. All these viruses are given species name based on cutoff of sequence similarity. Like in vigomoviruses, how much? 91% sequence similarity. If it is less, it will form a new species. In Bedna viruses, it is rtRNA H region, which is around 580 base pair. If it is more than 20%, only then you will call it as a separate species. So this is the 7.6 kb, you get multiple copy, and you have to use one unique restriction enzyme which will cut at one place. Then you get a linear amplicon, and that you can see on the agarose gel. So here the enzyme has cut only once, but the same enzyme in another sample produced two amplicon. That means it has cut at two places. But total of these two was 7.6. So that means it was a variant. So rolling circle amplification using restriction enzyme, you can determine the different isolates or strain even before sequencing. So I will just skip. Can you imagine PCR without thermal cycler? Yes? Lamp is one. Very good. Isothermal. What temperature? 64, 65 degrees. How many pairs of primer or how many sets of primer? Six primer sets you require. And? Okay. There is another isothermal amplification which does not require thermal cycler. It also does not require six sets of primer. It does require only one pair of primer. Okay? And so that what we call as recombinase polymerase assay. How many of you have heard? यहाँ के जो हैं उनको पता है. So this is the most recent development of PCR based assay. It is novel isothermal amplification. It was first introduced in 2006 by Pippenberg to test a pathogen called Staphylococcus aureus. How much time LAMP takes? 1 hour. This takes 20 minutes, 20 to 30 minutes. It can be performed at 37 to 39 degrees centigrade or even ambient room temperature. You can keep at the table, or you can hold between your forefinger and thumb. Hold for 20 minutes, PCR is done. So this is as simple as this. So here heat denaturation like PCR is not required. Another simplification here is, in LAMP you always require template nucleic acid isolation. Do you require or not? But in RPA you don't require. You can directly go for crude SAP. So simplification is at nucleic acid isolation, simplification is at thermal cycler level, you don't require, and time. You just can perform it in 20 to 25 minutes. And reaction is just like PCR. Reaction mixture comprises of one pair of primer, crude SAP, and a lyophilized pellet containing three core enzyme, what we call recombinase polymerase enzyme. So it comes in dry pellet form, so you don't require even lyophilization as such to store your enzyme. It can be used at room temperature, but for long storage you need to keep it in minus 20. So recombinase enzyme, polymerase enzyme consists of an enzyme called recombinase, which combines with the primer and targets the double-stranded DNA. Then there is a single-stranded binding protein, which stabilizes the displaced DNA strand bound with the primer. And then strand-displacing polymerase enzyme initiates synthesis at 3' end of the primer. So this is the process. It is more or less like PCR, except the denaturation process, okay? This is the graphical picture. Like, this is the primer which binds with the recombinase enzyme, and then it binds with the DNA strand, and then there is a displacement. And this displacement is stabilized by single-stranded binding protein, and then polymerase enzyme starts the synthesis. So in both direction, forward primer and reverse primer, and then synthesis of DNA takes place. So using this methodology, it was first time used for viruses in 2012 for Rift Valley fever virus, for foot and mouth disease virus in 13, dengue virus in 15, hepatitis C virus in 14, Zika virus in 16, herpes virus in 17, and ORF virus in 15, for human viruses. But for plant viruses, the first report came for little cherry virus 2 in 2014. Okay, that is the RNA virus. Then plum pox virus in 14, yam mosaic virus in 15, for a bigomo virus in 2016. Okay? And we also started working in the beginning of 2016 using for banana bunchy top virus, single-stranded DNA virus, and we published in Archives of Virology in 2017. Okay? So this is the only fifth paper in the world on RPA from this Advanced Center of Plant Virology. Then another paper has come in 2017, and in 2019 we modified this RPA and published for cucumber mosaic virus, which infects more than 1,000 host plants. Okay, so if we look at the simplicity, you just grind either in pestle mortar or polythene tube, and then you add this crude sap to this. This is the dry pellet of the enzyme. You reconstitute this with buffer and add one drop of this or 1 microliter. Keep at dry bath, 37 degree or room temperature, okay, for 20 minutes, and then you can run on the gel. you get the amplification. The another advantage is that you can clone and sequence, which is not possible with LAMP. So what is the difference in terms of primer length with conventional PCR? The length of primer here will be around 30 to 32 nucleotides compared to 18 to 25 nucleotides. The another limitation which we often encounter with RPA is that the amplification length or amplicon size cannot be more than 500. Ideally, it should be 150 to 300. Okay. So here, once we standardize, we have compared this with the banana plants collected from different parts of India. You can see the lower one is conventional PCR, and this one is RPA. So efficiency was 99%. So it was as good as conventional PCR. And this is the paper which has been published in Archives. Development of a recombinase polymerase amplification assay for
this in real time PCR, you can get this reaction in just 5 minutes. So despite the use of real time PCR,
we also wanted to use a fluorometer which can be used directly in the field, but this is here fluorometer. So you can see that the 27 samples out of 30 were positive. Only 3 samples out of 27 asymptomatic sample were positive, which was not as efficient as in case of RT-RPA, where number of samples, I think here number of figure is different. So the fluorometer was not very efficient for asymptomatic sample, but otherwise for symptomatic sample, it gave as good result as conventional real-time PCR. You can see here. So we also validated the field sample. So 6 samples which were positive in RT-PCR were also positive in fluorescence-based real-time detection using CrudeSAP. So this real-time PCR is using CrudeSAP. No isolation of RNA was required. So this is the difference between conventional PCR, LAMP, and RPA. Reaction time more than 2 hours, 60 minutes, 20 to 30 minutes. Requires expensive thermal cycler. These two don't require. Primer here, 4 to 6 sets of primer. Simple primer design, only 2 sets of primer. Single band is seen, multiple bands, single specific band. Multiplexing can be done. Here, no multiplexing. But here multiplexing is possible, which we have not yet attempted. So this was with regard to detection of one or few viruses. But if we come to the screening of broad spectrum detection of viruses, broad range screening. So in the beginning of my talk, I said how many viruses are known now? More than 2,000. But genome sequences are available only for 1,400 or 1,500 plant viruses. So we started working on a microarray DNA chip which can detect any of the known viruses whose genome sequence was available in 2011-12. And if there is in the challenges, I said, we have challenges to detect unknown viruses. So how to detect unknown viruses? One has to go through NGS, next generation sequencing. So this is a microarray chip which we developed with the, in association with FE Matrix. So in 2012-13, probes of all the known viruses and viroids were spotted on this chip, and total 1,572 probe sets for detection of viruses and viroids were spotted, and each probe set consisted of 7 to 11 probes, and both RNA and DNA viruses could be detected. So using this chip, both RNA and DNA viruses could be detected using RNA as a template. So it is not required that you go for DNA isolation. And the methodology was that you have to go for, after RNA isolation, you have to go for first strand cDNA synthesis, then promoter synthesis, and then you go for in vitro transcription using promoter. And then you have to label, you have to go for double stranded cDNA synthesis, and then you have to cut it and then label with biotin, and then you have to hybridize with the chip, the plant RNA, with the chip, and then wash, stain, and scan. The whole process takes about 2 days. Okay. So when we got this chip, we validated with different crops, but we did with grapevine because it is host of more than 70 viruses or viroids. So what we could get using the sample which we had collected in 2010. We had detected only three viruses, one, three, and only two viruses, one and three. The grapevine leaf roll associated virus 4 was detected using this chip initially. You can see here. Then we could also detect the grapevine virus F. We could also detect grapevine rupestris stem petting associated virus, and then 3 or 4 viroids. So using this chip, we could detect 8 pathogens at a time. If we had to use PCR primer, we would have never detected because we were not sure which virus is present out of 70 viruses. So using this chip, you can detect known viruses present in the sample, and these are the different cultivars which we have used for detection of viruses. Coming to NGS. It is high throughput sequencing technology. It directly detect, identify, and discover novel viruses in plants in an unbiased manner. Antibodies or prior sequence information is not required. So far, the technique which we talked about, either you require antibodies or you require sequence information, except in case of rolling circuit amplification, where you did not require prior sequence information. So using deep sequencing technology, a large number of viruses have been reported in grapevine, and new viruses and complete genome sequences have been obtained from different crops, like in tomato, potato spindle tuber viroid, near complete virus genome of Pepino mosaic virus, mixed infection of 2 strains of Pepino mosaic virus, and a novel, completely new portivirus was identified using deep sequencing. So I have taken one example which we have done here. Are you aware of leaf crinkle disease? Okay. I think in TNU work is going on. Okay? Huh? Okay. So this disease is known for more than 50 years, and we are still clueless which pathogen is causing this disease, in spite of availability of all modern tools. So in 2013, we started using NGS. So what we did, we took field samples, okay, and gave it for NGS. We encountered several viruses, but one virus we found was very new, Cowpea mildmortal virus. So that year we collected field sample, we did RT-PCR and ELISA for this virus, and we got in large number of samples. So based on this, we went for publication, but we never said that this virus is causing the disease, for the simple reason that next year, when we collected the sample, leaf crinkle sample, in none of the sample we could detect this virus, either by PCR or by ELISA. So it is quite possible that this virus, which is transmitted by white fly in a non-persistent manner, might have been introduced from other crops in the mung bean and urdbean both, and may not be producing the leaf crinkle disease symptom, but it is there. So we used the sample with the chip also, and unfortunately, it did not show reaction with any known virus. So we are not sure which virus is causing this disease. So of course, we use only siRNA, but now we know that RNA, total RNA, can be sequenced, and then we may find some lead for the association of virus. We also did NGS for the grapevine sample, which we had and did for microarray. And here the result was slightly different. In addition to the viruses which we got through NGS, through microarray, we got the association of GBA and GBF, which were not detected in microarray, but we could get through NGS. But this NGS did not detect stem pitting virus. So all these tools are not exclusive. They can be only complementary. Based on one result, we cannot say this virus is absent or present. One has to biologically confirm. They are merely tool. So in case of urdbean leaf crinkle, we could not biologically confirm or prove cause postulate. That is why we could not say that that virus is causing disease. We could also get the association of a virus which infected a fungus causing powdery mildew in grapevine. Powdery mildew is very common in grapevine. So using NGS, we could detect virus infecting powdery mildew fungus. So that was the last slide about NGS. I think I have taken 1 hour. And I hope you have enjoyed my talk. And if you have any query, any question, you are most welcome. So it was just an overview, because many other speakers will come. They will talk in detail about serological assay. They will talk about PCR. They will talk about rolling circle. I have just given an overview, okay? So that when they talk, you are having some idea. Bigomo virus, it is very simple. You transmit through white fly to a healthy plant. Sensitivity we found was comparable with the conventional PCR. Like we tested in banana.